stupid weeds. Actually, they're not really weeds. They're trees. Yes, trees growing up against my house. Can't have that. Yeah, I had that happen once. Trees growing up against the house, and then the roots, when the trees get bigger, they push into the foundation, they crack your foundation. Your life turns to suck really quick. Got to get them while they're young too. Otherwise, you get this thing, this big honking thing growing next to your house. Luckily, it hasn't messed with my foundation. Today is tree day, and I pruned this one a little bit, but I think I need to prune it a little bit more. This used to be a maple tree. This thing here used to be a huge maple tree. From what I can see of the stump that's left over, the stump is like this big around, and somebody cut it down long before I was here. I guess it might have been diseased, but what normally happens when you cut a tree down to a stump is you'll get these side shoots. People call them water sprouts. Well, all a water sprout is a fancy name for a shoot coming out of the trunk or the stem of the tree, and they'll eventually turn into branches, and this eventually turned into a whole bunch of branches, and I think that's kind of cool. One of the things I liked about having the 80 acres up in Minnesota is that there were so many maple trees, just endless maple trees. I had 80 acres, 80 acres of trees. There were oaks, pines, you name it, all kinds of trees up there. But one of the things that really blew my mind and really made me, I don't know, in the autumn I just sit out there and just smile, because the maple trees in the fall would turn this shocking red and orange and yellow, and the colors were just, you couldn't find them in any other trees. That's what I liked about maples. And when I moved out here to Iowa, I noticed that, you know, there are maple trees, there's just not as many maple trees. And I thought, wow, hopefully the place that I get has at least one, and it did, this thing. And but the problem is they cut it down, and now I have this. But what I'm doing with this, and I did this up north, is when you get these sprouts coming up, what are you? Kind of weird little beetle. I think it's a lightning bug, or they call them fireflies. Yeah, I think it's a firefly. But anyway, what I do is when these things start growing, they'll just grow really, really tall and turn into like little trees in their own right. But I don't want that. I want a bush. And I've done this before. If you prune these back, they will start branching out. I know, I'm pruning everything back. I am the pruner. I am Mr. Pruner on YouTube. And what happens is you prune them and they will send out side shoots. Trees will do the same thing as pepper plants and tomato plants. And that's what I did up north. I turned this old stump into what I call a maple bush. And it was just the most beautiful thing. And in the fall, it would turn this beautiful shade of red and yellow, and it was wonderful. So when I saw these sprouts coming out of here last year, it really made me happy. It's kind of like an old touch of my old home. So that's what I'm doing now, is I'm just pruning the branches back here and there. It doesn't really, I'm not going to give a demo on it because there really is no rhyme or reason to what I'm doing. If it's too tall in one spot, I cut it back. If it's too short, I let it go. And that's how I've been doing it. So now I turned this from just a couple little sticks into like this beginner rudimentary bush. So as the years go by, as you come by each year, you're going to see this thing. Hopefully it'll continue growing. It depends. Now if these are growing off the stump, what they're relying on is the roots of the original tree. If the stump dies and the roots die, these are going to die as well. But if these are low enough underground, if they're coming out from underground, they may have roots of their own. Don't know. I guess we'll just find out together. But I wanted to show you this because I don't think I've ever shown this before. I'm on my way to the apple tree because the apple tree needs a little bit of pruning. And oh gosh, you'll know what I mean when I get there. Take a look at this. This isn't the one I was talking about. It's on the way. But I wanted to show you this because when I moved here, I noticed that there were more than just the big apple trees that I showed you on other episodes. There were these little ones, but they were so lost in the weeds, I didn't even know I had them. And what was happening is the weeds were so tall, this tree right here, which is an apple tree, don't know what kind because it hasn't produced apples yet. I have no idea. I guess we'll find out together. And this tree over here is a peach tree. I didn't even know I had a peach tree. And when I cleared away all the weeds and looked around, I thought, wait a minute, these were planted here. So whoever used to live here ages ago wanted to have fruit trees, and they planted them here. But the only problem is they moved and then the weeds took over. But this one, last year, I went crazy on it. It was just weird, ugly looking thing. And I started pruning the branches out. Now, you remember the pruning episode on the Honeycrisp tree, that big apple tree. I cut out the whole center. I went up there with a chainsaw, whack, and I took the whole top of the tree off, which is a major portion of the tree. The bulk of the tree went off into the distance. I cut it out to where it would be kind of like a bowl shape, because that's how I want my apple tree to grow. Kind of like a bowl shape, and then the branches will grow out instead of up, because, you know, I'm only a couple feet tall and I can't reach the apples way up on top. I could get one of those extender poles. Thing is, the birds like to go up to the top parts of the tree and peck at the apples to get a taste, and so do the squirrels. They don't much care for the lower parts of the tree, so I want the tree to grow lower so that I can actually reach the apples and the birds aren't as attracted to a low-growing tree. That's just my experience with it. I don't know where Rascal is today. He went off into the weeds and that's the last I ever saw of him. But anyway, this tree here, I started cutting out the center and it's doing really good. Problem is, the goats like apple trees. Yes, goats will eat your apple trees. So if you have goats, and I don't encourage you to get them unless you're really in for a lot of work and responsibility, make sure you fence your apple trees really, really well, because they will take them out just like that. They're faster than grasshoppers and aphids. They will eat your trees. This one is growing really well. I cut out the center of it, and now we have nice solid branches coming out. And that's what I was always promoting when I was showing you the other pruning episode. You want those branches to come out from the sides and to grow out and open up the center, because eventually it'll want to fill out all by itself. But you want to make sure you get these things growing out and don't have them cross over. We don't want crossovers on the trees. Okay, now that I've shown you the easy tree, let's go see the big one, okay? Oh boy. Yeah, all kinds of growth coming out of here. Those of you who have followed my programs, you saw in last autumn, early winter, I came out here after the tree had stopped growing. Now, I only prune my trees when the sap stops flowing. It's a lot easier on my trees. Some people do it another way. This is just how I do it. When I was a kid, I told you that I lived with my dad, and we were in the apple orchards of Washington State, and we picked apples. And then as soon as the apple picking season was over in the fall, after the leaves were falling off the trees and the sap stopped flowing, they have apple pruning season. And that's when you go in and you prune the apple trees and give them the shape that they want so that it's easier for you to get in there and get the apples the next year. That's how they work it up there. And that's where I got my information. So there may be different ways to do things. This is just how I do it. So what I did was I came out here with a chainsaw because, you know, that's what I do. I got a chainsaw and I cut the whole top of the tree off. Just the whole top went bye-bye. And what I want it to do is I want it to grow out off to the side so that I can actually get the apples out. And this is how it worked. What happened was the branches that were going out to the side, it was kind of like a bowl shape in a way. And it was going out like this. And then when the leaves came out, it added a lot of weight to the branches, and the branches are going down like this. Okay, that's what they're doing right now. They're going way down, but they're going down farther than I want them to go down. I don't need these branches touching the ground. I mean, I'm not that short. So, and it's also an invitation for fungus and for humidity. So I don't want them to go too awful low. I want them down to where I can reach them. I just don't need them this far down. So what I'm going to be doing, normally I would wait until fall to prune these, and I probably will wait to prune the bulk of them, but the worst of the branches that are way, way down, I want to make sure that I get those pruned. And there is no actual cardboard cutout tutorial I can give you for pruning your trees. Normally, you're going to be looking at pruning your small trees. You know, you plant a tree, you want it to grow just right, you prune it as it goes. That's the way to go. This tree was never done like that. So I'm actually correcting missed growth and damage that was done throughout the years. So it's a lot more work for me. That little tree I showed you, that's easy. That's very easy. So when you're doing your trees, start pruning them early, getting the center part out, making the branches grow where you want them to grow. Anything that's not growing in that direction, get rid of it. And that way, you're not going to end up with a disaster that you're going to have to just go nuts on. And my little tiny pruners are definitely not going to do the job. I have to get the big ones out later. But to get the weight off of some of these, what I want to make sure I do is don't cut off any branches that have apples on them, because I want the most apples I can get. And one thing I can advise you on here, this is very important, don't expect too much from your trees right off the bat. Trees are not tomato plants. Trees aren't pepper plants. These are not things that are going to give you instant results. Trees are in it for the long haul. These are slow growers. They move at a whole different time and space than vegetable plants, okay? They are slow growers. Even though they tend to grow fast, they're not like vegetables. They're going to grow a little bit slower. They're going to produce a lot slower. But the thing is that we're in it for the long term with these trees, so we want to be patient with them. Now, when I pruned off a lot of branches, what it did was it put the energy out to its other branches. And that's what I wanted it to do. The thing is, it put it out into growth. And you'll look at a lot of these branches, they don't have fruit on them. And that's okay, because a lot of the fruit was probably going to be set on the top. So what I'm doing is I sacrificed the fruiting this year for a later year, okay? So all the branches that are out right now will probably set spurs and set fruit next year. Now, what I'm going to do is I'm going to take the branches that don't have apples, because since I don't have a whole lot of apples on these trees, I want to make sure I preserve the branches that have apples. This one is really heavy and it's laying over, but so I want to shorten it down. So what I'm going to do is just reach up in here. I'm going to reach up, take off maybe a couple feet, and just snip it. This is why I needed to get my bigger pruners. I came out here with the camera and I brought out the smaller ones. I was totally underestimating this tree. But anyway, I'm going to take these over to the goats, because the goats will definitely chew these up. If you have some way to shred them up, throw them in your compost pile or pile them in the back of your yard. Eventually they will break down. But the goats love apple trees, so nothing goes to waste here. This apple tree is going to go through their digestive system and come out as poo, and that's going to go back into the garden. But anyway, what this is doing is this is going to lighten the load on this branch here, and it's crossing over here. So I want to make sure I take off part of this over here. When you have branches that cross over, what they're doing is they're going to rub like this. And what that does is it damages the bark, and that's not good for your tree. So if you have branches that are laying on top of others that are rubbing, make sure you get rid of one or the other. Keep the best looking one, get rid of the ugly one. And when I take the ends off of here a couple feet, what that's going to do is that is going to lighten these branches. And it's not going to do it immediately. Like I said, everything runs a little bit slower when it comes to trees. It's going to take the load off, and as it grows, it's going to come out a little bit higher, and it's not going to be quite so low to the ground. And that's what I'm looking for. Any of these long stragglers, we're sorry, you got to go. And there we go. And what's going to happen is with these shorter branches, it's going to be lighter on the tree. The branches are going to thicken up, and they're going to be able to hold the fruit a lot easier. Now, I cut these down a couple feet, but see right in here, yep, right in there, we have apples. So we don't want to take it any farther than in here, otherwise we lose the apples. In an emergency, or if it really, really, really had to go, I would do it. But you know what? Nothing's that big of an emergency on this tree. So I'm going to let that stay there. Maybe in time, after I harvest the apples, I'll take them down. Like I said, in the fall is when I do my main pruning, because then the leaves are gone and I can get a really clear view of the branches, and then I know what to prune. But pruning in the summertime, I don't know, it's hot, it's humid. The tree doesn't recover as fast as it does when it's in the fall, because in the fall the sap isn't running and there's not as much damage to the tree. Now, right over here to the left of where I was working, these are branches that are a bit higher. See how they're about face height? That's exactly what I want. I don't want them too awful high. I mean, a little bit higher is fine. I can reach that with one of those apple grabber things. That's fine. But any lower, I really don't want. So I have some stuff that's growing down here. It isn't putting out any apples at all, and it's not getting light. So these branches are really kind of worthless. These are the ones that I want to promote. So I'm going to take out that one underneath. It's going to bring in some airflow. It's going to take some load off the tree, because they're not putting out as much energy into the tree as the ones that are actually getting the light. Anything that's shaded is not going to be getting the benefit of the sunshine. So it's more of a drain on the plant than a benefit to the plant. But these ones, yep. And by the way, I know, you're looking at these and you're seeing the clusters of apples, and I probably should have picked off a couple of these so the apples could grow and get bigger, but I just couldn't bring myself to do that. I'm funny that way. I don't know why. I just can't seem to do that. So I'm going to just let them grow the way that they want to grow. And there's going to be some falling on the ground from being pushed off of the stems, and those ones are going to probably go to the goats or chickens. So nothing goes to waste here. Okay, I'm holding you up about maybe 4 feet over my head so that you can get a really good look at the top of the tree. See all those new sprouts that are shooting straight up? People call those water sprouts, and those are just new branches. And the new branches will generally grow straight up. That's how you can tell the new stuff. Now, that's gonna fill in the center of the tree. And with just a little bit of effort and Rascal's help, of course, I managed to get all of that inner growth out. And that's what I wanted to do. I wanted to make sure that that new growth that was coming up, just filling up the inside, was removed, because that serves no purpose at all for me. I want to make sure that the inside is nice and clear so that I can get in there and pick any apples that come off the inner branches. And also it helps keep the airflow going really good, which keeps the fungus down. Yep, all gone. And what I'm going to do is I'm just going to take these branches and hit them with the mower, and it'll just shred them up and throw them all over the place. I took a big pile of them, took them over to the goats. The goats love them, but they can only eat so much. I mean, there is a limit to what they can eat. And apparently a big honking pile of branches is their limit. But what I did was I took out the inside of this tree. Now, with a mature tree like this, that's what I want to do. I want to clear out all that new growth, because that's never going to serve a purpose. It's just going to fill up the tree, and in a few years, I'm going to be in the same predicament I was in before. And I don't want to have to go through this again. So the more you snip them out, the less they're going to start coming back in the future. You just keep going and keep going. It's one of those things. It's a long process. It's not something instant like you prune a pepper plant and it's done. This is a long-term project that I'm going to have to do every single year, because it took a while for this tree to get this way. It's going to take a while to take it out the way that I want. Now, as I take off the branches, I think I showed you how I took this one off. This is a long, swooping branch that came way down. Now, I didn't need that long branch, so I cut it back about halfway. That lightens the load. Same thing all the way around the tree. I took the branches and I took them shorter. What that's going to do, it's going to make a lot sturdier branches in the long run. The ones that are remaining are going to get thicker, and also they don't have that droopiness to them, and they don't have the sway as much. They're going to be a lot stronger to hold fruit in the future. All these little sprouts here in the middle, I'm going to have to remove some of those. Not all of them. Some of them I want them to grow to fill in these empty spaces, but I raised the tree up so it's a lot less, you know, all over the ground, I guess. And I can get underneath here and mow, and also it keeps the humidity down. Now, with the gaps that I have inside of here, that's going to give room for the wind to blow through. Before, my tree was so thick that when the wind hit it, the whole tree went like this. And although that looked kind of cool, it was knocking the apples against each other, and that was bruising the apples, and that's not a good thing. So with more gaps in here, it's going to help the breeze blow through, and I'm going to leave the strongest of the branches all the way around this tree, and that's going to give for a lot more strength to the apples. It's kind of like the theory, and I'm going by just my practice, my ideas, and the way I do things. It's definitely not the way any kind of pro would do it, and that's okay. That's okay. I don't ever want to be a pro. But my theory is that I want to have just a few stronger branches to get some good apples, because a lot of apples means nothing to me if they're all tiny and I have to work a lot more to get my apples processed. I'd rather have fewer apples and have them larger and juicier than a whole bunch of smaller apples that really aren't as worth as much to me. And also, like grapevines. Grapevines, they grow them for production. They don't grow them to be beautiful. They grow them nice and sturdy, and they cut off the weaker branches, and they allow the stronger ones to go. And they only have like a couple branches per vine, and that way you get the bigger things of grapes. Same process and the same theory I'm doing for the apple tree. This isn't grown to be beautiful. Trust me, this apple tree is not a beauty, but it's going to be for production. If I wanted a beautiful tree, I would have left it, because it was a big, beautiful, tall tree, but it wasn't serving my purpose. And I have a lot of beautiful trees out here. This one is not going to be grown to be a beauty. It's going to be growing apples for me. So this is my method of pruning, and I'm going to continue in the fall as soon as I get all the apples off here, because some of the branches I couldn't cut off because they had apples on them. So once the harvest is done, once the sap stops flowing, and once these mosquitoes quit biting my head, the sap stops flowing, I'll do a final pruning on this for the year. That'll pretty much be it. I know it's not really technical and it's not really in-depth, but there really is no rhyme or reason to this. It's more art than function for me, because I just look at what doesn't look right. What's crowding another branch? Take off the one that seems the less valuable to me. Like if two branches are crowding, I'll always take the one below it, because it just seems like this one's going to be hitting it. I would rather take the lower one than the higher one. And that way the higher one can just swoop down like that. Oh, I think I'm getting bit on the forehead again. Stupid mosquitoes. Anyway, that is the apple trees. That's how I prune my apple trees. Just one step of many. And if you have any questions concerning pruning your trees, because I noticed that a couple people were asking me, Ray, when are you going to do the apple tree? I'm going to be doing mine. Well, this is what I do. I just trim off the branches that are kind of crowding each other, and that's how I do it. If you have any questions concerning yours, post them in the comment section below or get a hold of me on Facebook. And if you have a picture, maybe I can help you, because that's what happened when a couple people had their trees. They would give me a nice clear picture of their tree, and they said, Ray, where would you prune this? And I would take the picture, download it to my computer, put it on Photo Magic or some kind of program to edit, and I would put like red lines on the branches that I cut. It's a lot easier than trying to explain it to you. So that's what I would do. No charge either. But that's how I do my apple tree. I hope you guys enjoyed this. And I want to go to the smaller trees. Let's go to the smaller trees. I don't know exactly what type of tree this is, but I do know that it is a plum tree. A viewer sent me two plum trees this spring, and thank you, by the way. Thank you very much. They are doing fine. These are your plum trees, this one and that one over there. I don't think that's on frame right now, but I planted them right out in front of my house. They're about maybe 12 feet from my house, because what I wanted is for these plum trees to grow right by my dining room window, because I like to sit at my dining room table and look out here in the winter and watch the birds eat out of the feeder and stuff. And also in the summer, you can see the sun rise over here. You know that picture of the sunrise? Yeah, that picture of the sunrise is what you get when you look out my dining room window right over here. So I like to look out there in the morning and watch the sun come up. But when plum trees are in bloom, in full bloom, when you have if you've ever been near a plum tree in the spring and it's in full bloom, the smell is amazing. And the breeze comes through the pine trees. So I get a ever so slight breeze of pine and then these, and it blows right inside my window in my living room over by my desk when I'm answering comments and stuff like that. I get this. So that's why I planted these here. These are going to grow right out in front of my house. Plus, the deer don't like to come up too close to the house. They're a little bit skittish. They like to stay off in the distance, and that's good because they will absolutely eat your little fruit trees. I don't care what kind of fruit trees they are. Peach trees, apple trees, plum trees. Deer will eat anything, and they'll eat it down to nubs. They're faster than goats, and the goats don't come near these trees. I keep them on the other side of the house. But this is a beauty. This one just came in as a stick. Just a few little sticks coming out, and it's all in a box, and I planted it, and I thought, wow, how sad is that? Because when you buy trees, you get them in a box. When you order them from nurseries, you know, you order bare root stocks, you get this stick, and you stick it in the ground, and you're like, Well, I gave a demo on how to plant trees, and if I can find it, I'll put the link down. Actually, I'm not going to put the link down because it's a little bit late to be planting trees. Most places aren't selling trees right about now. It's usually a spring thing or a fall thing. But anyway, I planted this, I dug a hole, I put some compost in there and loosened up the soil. And by the way, you might notice that right around the base, I don't have any kind of mulch or anything. A lot of people will mulch around the bottoms of their trees to hold in the moisture. What I do is I cut off the cap of grass, set it off to the side, and then I dig the hole and I put everything in there. Then I put the cap of grass right back on top. The reason I do that is so that the grass can act as a living mulch. It protects the soil, and it doesn't take any nutrients away from the trees because the tree roots are way down deeper than the grass roots. So I don't know where everybody gets this thing about don't keep the grass around your trees, it's going to steal nutrients. It doesn't. And also, when you're feeding your garden, on last episode you saw me use the compost tea, don't forget to feed your trees. I know, it seems kind of weird that you'd want to feed your trees. You think, nobody feeds their trees. They just kind of grow in the dirt. No, they don't. These trees, especially when they're small, they definitely need to be fed, and they will benefit from compost tea. This little stick only had a few little sticks coming out, but look, with the compost tea, it's growing beautifully. The leaves are coming out fast and furious on this thing. It's looking absolutely beautiful, but there is a little branch over here that needs to come off. We're sorry, you gotta go. There, because it was growing on top of another branch. And like I said, don't want branches on top of each other. There, There we go. It's kind of like a little bit of a bonsai type of thing, only I'm not promoting the weaker of the branches to come out. I just kind of look at it, and I can't really tell you how I do it. I just kind of do it. So however you choose to do your plants, do them that way. If you have any questions concerning your trees, let me know. But make sure you feed them and water them, especially during the summer. They're definitely going to appreciate it. And younger trees, more so than older trees, have the delicate roots that are just getting started, and they need all the food and all the support they can get. So make sure you water them, make sure you pour on that compost tea as much as you want, and your trees are gonna thank you, because the first couple years are the important years for them to get those roots down, to get the tree established, and then they'll start putting out flowers and then reward you with the fruit. So we're in it for the long haul when it comes to trees, folks. So take care of your trees, and in the years to come, they're going to look beautiful. I'm going to show you these as the years go by. You're going to be here, and I'm going to be here. As the years go by, remember this little tiny thing, okay? Because I'm going to take another shot as the years go by, as this thing gets bigger and bigger. But I want you to remember this thing when it was just a little bit of a baby. We are going to have plums. Thank you, everybody, for joining me for this episode on Rudimentary Tree Care. We have a peach tree right here, and it actually has little peaches on it. It had little peaches when I bought it, and I thought they'd fall off, because usually when they have fruit on it and you're transplanting them, they tend to go through a little bit of a shock. But no, it has little tiny peaches. I don't know if they're going to taste very good or not, because they're only the size of golf balls. But I have a peach tree there. We have a plum. We have another plum, and we have another peach right down the line. So we have a whole... Hi there. Smell my apple branch. We have a whole line of fruit trees, and hopefully with a little bit of luck and a lot of care, these are going to be big, beautiful fruit trees all along the front of the house in the years to come. Ha! It's making me happy. I love coming outdoors first thing in the morning and seeing these things, and hopefully I'll be picking fruit in future episodes. Keep your fingers crossed. Like I said, got any questions or concerns, post it in the comment section below. Until then, I'm going to go feed these to the goats. Thanks, everybody, for joining me. Have a great day.